Starting in goal for the Oilers, as he has for 65 of the Oilers' 67 games, Grant Fuhr, who signed a new multi-year contract earlier this week. And for the Calgary Flames, it will be their workhorse, Mike Vernon, making his 53rd appearance. He needs one more victory to tie a Flames record with 32 wins. And Harry, both of these teams coming off impressive wins over the Philadelphia Flyers.
Well, the Flyers were a little undermanned, but to beat the Flyers at any time, anywhere, under any conditions is a big win. And these two teams are going to go right till early April to decide who wins the Smythe division.
Interesting starting lineup for the Oilers as Marty McSorley takes the spot on right wing with Mark Messier and Glenn Anderson. The Flames counter with Joel Otto, Tim Hunter, and Colin Patterson. And here comes Anderson into the zone. Anderson had four goals last night against the Flyers. And they start very quickly. Here's Patterson over the line. Puts on the brakes, being watched by Lowe. McCrimmon shot, deflected wide off the stick of Pookaboo. There's a shot on goal, and Fuhr kicks that aside. Anderson can't get it by McCrimmon. Brad McCrimmon, plus 33 this year, moves it behind the net. Number 33, McSorley around the boards, and there's Messier. Messier being watched by Hunter. Gets it ahead, and here's McSorley with Anderson. Anderson takes a look, return pass, and McSorley can't get a shot away. Out comes Wayne Gretzky, 5 points last night. Otto for the Flames, up ahead to Gary Suter. Number two among NHL defensemen in scoring. Suter taken out by Randy Gregg. And Esa Tikkanen has it. Can't get by Hokanlou. And now the doctor has the puck for the Oilers. Randy Gregg playing his second game. Here's Nieuwendyk, the drive. That just missed. Joe Nieuwendyk around the boards, and Gretzky will take it on the other side. Here's Steve Smith over to Gregg, and Gregg clears it into the Flames zone. There's a giveaway, and Gregg has it at the point, shoots right on, that hit Gretzky's stick in the crease, and bounce out. Close call for the Oilers. Here comes Lube. Pass for Lube behind him. Lube had four goals against the Flyers on Thursday night. Long pass for Gretzky, almost took his head off, and offside is the call. This is Hockey Night in Canada from the Olympic Saddle Dome in Calgary.
In Toronto, the game is only 9 seconds old when the Leafs give up the puck at the blue line. Mark Kumpel goes in with Dale Hawerchuk. Perfect pass from Kumpel. Hawerchuk's 40th goal of the season behind Ken Reggett. 1-0 Winnipeg.
Here we've played a minute 53 of this eighth meeting between the Flames and Oilers. Face-off outside the Oilers' blue line. Charlie Huddy across to Craig Muni. Up front is Mike Krushelnicki, and on left wing is Craig Simpson. Here's Simpson back for Krushelnicki. And so Glenn Sather has made an interesting lineup shuffle tonight. Simpson, who had two goals last night working with Messier and Anderson, is on with Krushelnicki, and that's Simpson with the puck. 45 goals this year. A career season for Simpson. Mike Buller takes over for the Flames. Up to Tonelli and Joey Mullen. Here come the Flames. Merzen trailing. His shot is deflected into the corner. At the point, Natras loses it. And a nice check by Natras. And that broke up a 3-on-2 for the Oilers.
Amazing. When you cause 3-on-2s, what you'll do to prevent them. Natras made a desperation lunge and saved a tough situation for the Flames.
Here's Krushelnicki dumping it in. The Oilers will make a change. Vernon leaves it for McCrimmon. A hit to Suter. Nice pass to Lanny McDonald back in the Flames lineup. Shane Cherla with him. Cherla going after it against Kevin Lowe. But the veteran Oiler defenseman comes up with it. Puck cleared out to center. Acton giving chase. It's Acton, Dave Hannon, and Craig McTavish. That line intact from last night. Lanny McDonald dodges a hit. Pookaboo around the board. Dave Hannon, he's taken out of the play. That's Cherla trying to feed the backhand pass to McDonald, but Craig McTavish starts back with Keith Acton. At the line, the pass for Hannon, and McDonald does a good job defensively. Here comes Gary Suter, 3-on-3. Suter, the long shot, and Fuhr kicks that aside. Mark Messier bounced off a hit from Gary Roberts. And now we'll have our first penalty of the game. It's going to go against the Flames, and Anderson will circle. Grant Fuhr to get to the bench.
Pretty debatable call, but Myers snowed for being tough in the first period.
Pass for Craig Simpson, cross ice for Gretzky, cut off. And so a penalty about to be assessed to the Flames. Hockey Night in Canada returns in a moment.
Gary Roberts gets a holding penalty to give the Oilers the first power play opportunity. There it is. Oh, he's got to hold a Messier stick. And they're calling that very strictly this year in the National League. And the Oilers, whose power play is 11th, but was hot last night, get a chance to go ahead in this game.
They clicked for four last night, Harry. It's Gretzky, Anderson, Simpson, Messier, and Smith. Joel Otto and Colin Patterson out to kill the penalty. Here comes Steve Smith. On left wing to Anderson, he deflects it down into the corner. Vernon out of the net, gives way to Suter. Messier keeps it in. Brad McCrimmon will try, and he gets it by Smith and down the ice.
The one thing Edmonton's needed all year is a good power play point man. And say they may find one in the next couple of days.
Trade deadline is March the 8th, and there's a lot of speculation that both these teams might be involved.
Well, they both think they have a good chance of winning the Cup, as does Philly and Boston. And the one common characteristics all four of those teams have, they don't trust their backup goalie if he had to play a playoff round.
Puck is shot in. Now Randy Gregg will take a spot at the point along with Kevin Lowe. And that clearing pass goes over the glass and out of play.
Well, there's the Edmonton bench with the general manager, coach Glenn Sather, at the far end of it. This is his 706th game as the coach general manager. He's won 401 of them. He is famous. I think only one year in all his years as the managing coach of the Oilers has he not made a move at the trading deadline. And I don't think this year will be an exception. 9 seasons doing both jobs, 3 Stanley Cups, and his coffee move starts preparing the Oilers for trying to start the Stanley Cup brain again 4 or 5 years from now, as you don't win Stanley Cups by 1 year planning.
42 seconds left in the penalty, and Sather all but confirmed earlier this week that he will deal Andy Moog before the deadline. Here comes Jari Kurri with Gretzky and Tikkanen. Gretzky, 5 assists last night. Tikkanen at the side of the net, looking for the point for Randy Gregg. Shot right on. Loose puck. Gretzky's there, and they can't get a shot away. Tikkanen back to Gregg. Kevin Lowe out in front. That goes by Gretzky. Back to the point for Gregg. Lowe with it again. Look for Gretzky. Now shoots, and Vernon makes the stop. McInnes comes up with it, and the Flames return to full strength. Roberts back on the ice, and now the Flames will make the lineup changes, and the fans appreciate the job they did killing that penalty.
Well, the Oilers, Chris, never got a real good chance. They had one shot from the point, through some traffic, but Vernon found it and stopped it.
So it's still scoreless here early in the first period.
There's the Calgary bench, and at the far end of that one is Terry Crisp. He knows the advantage of first overall in the league, the extra home games and all around for the playoffs, avoiding Winnipeg in the first round, and of course a chunk of the $200,000 the league gives to the team that finishes first overall. And we all know most coaches don't make what most players make.
Although some coaches were different, I think you were in that category, weren't you?
Don't be silly, Chris.
13 and a half minutes remaining in the first period. Oilers forechecking. They have Acton, McTavish, and Hannon out. John Tinelli can't control the puck, and now Gary Suter dumps it in the corner. There's Dave Hannon, hard-working forward, who's impressed the Oilers this year, but loses the puck, and John Tinelli almost had a break. Charlie Huddy just got back in time, and he'll flip it down the ice.
And the fans are trying to help Bob Myers referee the game, but so far he's not listening to him.
Tinelli was ducked down in the Oilers' zone. The play continues. McTavish to Messier. A shot from a bad angle. Vernon covered the short side. At the point, Huddy's shot knocked down by Bullard. And Tinelli gives off to McCrimmon. Out to Bullard, and he sidestepped one check and got hammered by Messier. Bullard goes to the bench, and here comes Anderson. Wheeling in. Backhand, and Vernon gloves it and knocks it to the corner. Nobody cuts in off the wing better than Glenn Anderson.
I agree with you there. Nobody.
Here's Rick Natras shooting right on. Tucked up on the dasher, and Steve Smith will handle it there and hold it for a faceoff. 12-13 remaining in the first period. Still no score.
You can see that this is an even series. These teams are tied in the series. They're tied in the last 10 games. They're only 1 point between them in the standings. Last Sunday in Edmonton, Calgary won a very tight defensive struggle, 3-2, with only a total of 40 shots on goal. Very strange for the top two offensive teams in the National League.
It's also strange, Harry, that although the Flames are even in this series, they're winless at home in three starts. Here's Messier with the steal, and Vernon almost got caught. Natras, ahead to Otto. Otto is checked by McSorley, and Merzen clears it out to center. Joel Otto, right wing to Tim Hunter. Over the line, Patterson, Hunter, and Fuhr makes the stop. Best chance so far for the Flames. Here's Mark Messier. He was ejected from last night's game early in the first period for being third man in an altercation. So he'll have fresh legs tonight. Bukaboom around the boards. Kevin McClellan out for his first shift. Esa Tikkanen. He's hit, and Steve Smith will try to get it out for Edmonton. Smith takes a look and just finds a hole and clears it down the ice. And Merzen goes back to touch it. Icing is the call.
Well, early in the game, it looks like Terry Crisp wants to put offense against offense as Joel Nieuwendyk started that shift against Gretzky. Tim Hunter played with Chirla and Roberts Thursday night against Philadelphia on the search and destroy unit for Calgary. A lot of good hits. Here's a good chance. McSorley, 33, ties up Hunter just enough so Hunter, or Otto, just enough so Otto can't get a lot on that shot.
There's a look at Grant Fuhr, who's been in the lineup almost every night. Not in the lineup for the Flames tonight. Bradley, Bozic, Perdina, Barazan, and Reinhardt. The scratches for the Oilers are Norm Lacombe and Steve Dykstra. We were a little disappointed that Yuri Herdina would not play tonight after an impressive NHL debut on Thursday.
I was looking forward to that, too. He was good. Good-looking hockey player Thursday night.
Here's Håkan Lund, who had a tremendous night on Thursday. First four-goal game of his career. He has 38 for the season. Luke tried that little back pass. Now Luke kicks it in, shoots, and whistled that one wide. Nieuwendyk to Luke. Luke shoots, and Fuhr will hang on for a saw. Jeff Bukaboom and Jim Poplinski having words.
Fighting for territory in the crease.
From the Olympic Saddle Dome in Calgary, this is Hockey Night in Canada.
Well, in games against these two teams have played against the top eight teams. The Flames are 14-7-1, and Edmonton 8-12-2, which has got to please Terry Crisp and worry Glenn Sather a little bit.
One other note of concern for Glenn Sather is that his team is one game below 500 on the road this year, which is the first time in many years that has happened. Oilers forechecking. Muni comes up with a puck. Here's Simpson, the backhand, and Vernon made the stop. Simpson just five short of his first 50-goal season. Here comes Joey Mullen. Mullen against Charlie Huddy. Huddy with the check. Krushelnicki helps out. Can he clear it? Past McCrimmon and out to center ice. Some of the sticks starting to get up high already. Suter flips it in. The Flames will make a change. Huddy to Curry, and he just backhands it out down the ice. Keith Acton scoots after it. He's one of the quickest guys on the ice tonight. And Lanny McDonald comes up with it for the Flames. Here's Rick Natras. Gary Roberts and McDonald breaking. McDonald over the line. High shot. And Fuhr took that off his chest. Lanny McDonald back in the lineup tonight because the Flames like the way he's played against the Oilers this year. Here's Acton with a burst of speed. Centers it. Greg moves in. One of the Flames is shaken up and play is whistled down.
Bearcat Murray's out there very quickly. It's either Roberts or it's Gary Roberts, and he seemed to get hit in the face. I thought it might be number 11. and not Roberts. He went down quickly, and you can see with no numbers on the rear end of their pants, it's tough to tell who this guy is. But he obviously got hit in the face. There was no penalty called, and it happened behind the play. But our guys in the truck, they haven't missed one yet. They're not starting tonight. Take a look at 10 and 12 Hannon. You wonder why Roberts is going down after that check. But Hannon's skate may have clipped him as Roberts threw a pretty nice check on him.
He has really been an addition for the Flames in that department, hitting hard of late and playing that grinding style. Gary Roberts still getting attention. We hope he'll be all right, and we will be back with more of the first period after this.
This has been a very tame game from the physical or emotional department. I think there's more emotion in the crowd than there is on the ice so far, and that's not the case in most of these Battle of Alberta games.
From the faceoff, McInnes was grabbed by McSorley, and there'll be a penalty against the Oilers, and the Flames will have their first power play advantage. Vernon comes out of the net. They have an extra attacker on, but Cure touches it. And here comes the first penalty against the Oilers, and it goes to Marty McSorley.
Well, Marty McSorley, with that penalty, which wasn't the smartest one he's ever taken, gives the number one power play team in the league a chance to go ahead in this game. One thing to remember, that the Oilers are dynamite in shorthanded goals. So it doesn't mean that you're home free when you get a chance to have a power play against Edmonton. But watch the two-point men. They are the key, McInnes and Suter, to the power play for Calgary. They both have great shots. They force the penalty-killing forwards to get out right on them, and that either opens up the inside play or they get those rockets through. Somebody tips it, or it's screened, or it simply beats the goalie. They both can really shoot it.
Craig McTavish and Mark Messier have to kill the penalty. Here's Messier, two on two. McTavish moved in offside, so Messier just darts back into the Oilers zone. When the Flames get possession, watch for Joe Nieuwendyk as well. He has 29 power play goals this year.
And he'll operate in front of the net. He may slide off to the side, but eventually when he thinks that point shot's coming, he goes to the front. Great hand-eye coordination. Gets a lot of tip in.
Here comes Lou with Nieuwendyk. Lou breaking in. Takes a look. Nieuwendyk the pass, but he couldn't get a shot away. Back it comes to the point. Suter flips it around the glass. It's up on the dasher, and Bullard couldn't bring it down. Now it's Nieuwendyk. He takes a hit and is ridden off the puck, and Steve Smith takes over and sends it down the ice.
Well, Calgary love to get the puck in control in the opposition zone, set up, and they use their point men better than any power play in the league.
Flames have 86 goals with the man advantage. That was not a particularly good pass. In fact, it thought it might have been icing as McInnes cleared it the length of the ice, but play continues. Brian Glynn hammers it in. Otto for Joey Mullen. Tonelli goes to the front of the net. Here's Otto. Back to the point. Glynn. McCrimmon shot right on. Rebound scores! John Tonelli.
Well, there's that point shot I was talking about. McCrimmon one-timed it. Cure made the stop. But look in front of the net. 27. He grabs the rebound. Now the Oilers had three people there, and so did the Flames. The one Oiler forward left to get the 3-on-2, and John Tonelli jumps on the puck and puts it in for his 14th goal of the year and his 11th point in the last eight games.
It is a power play goal. Brad McCrimmon and Brian Glynn get the assists on John Tonelli's 14th, and as you mentioned, he's been on a bit of a tear of late. And I think partly in response to the added traffic in Flames camp right now. They've got such competition for jobs, and Tonelli doesn't want to lose his.
You have a bad practice, you don't play this, Bob. They had 30 guys at practice on Thursday. They since have sent one down. In fact, they divided their team into two squads so they could have a good practice.
Tell you, Mike Keenan was awfully envious yesterday in Edmonton because he has lost four frontline players from the Flyers. And he'd love to have the depth the Flames have right now. Here come the Oilers. McClelland over the line. Playing with Gretzky and Tikkanen right now. Puck is backhanded around the boards. Kurla is fighting for it with Huddy. Huddy gulped at it. Then Vernon makes the save and hangs on. The Flames have the lead on John Tinelli's 14th of the year.
John Tinelli, the energetic winger of the Flames, came out in the second power play group. The puck goes back to the point. Watch the three red shirts go to the front of the net. And sure enough, the puck comes right out to one of them, Tinelli, and he puts it in.
Here's a long pass for Shane Chirla. He hits breaking Joe Neuendijk, knocked down as he tried to go between Muni and Huddy.
Well, they got enough of Neuendijk, who tried the aerial route between the two of them and didn't make it. And the puck went on to Fuhr, and Muni got a piece of him. This guy's playing a lot better hockey than he was earlier in the year after a great season last year. Here's Neuendijk in the aerial route. No penalty. And they rarely give a penalty if the forward tries to jump between the defensemen. And Bob Myers has come up with penalties here. I have to admit, I didn't see who got them. McClellan is one, 24. He may be the only one.
Well, the way the fans are reacting, that seems to be the case. Kevin McClellan was in a pair of set two last night against the Flyers. He tangled with Dave Brown and Greg Smith, and he's not happy with the call. Well, they've given him a misconduct, so it won't cost the Oilers a manpower advantage.
And I think he was yapping at Myers from the bench, and that's why we missed the penalty. And Myers is a referee, and he's refereed long enough that you ought to know, if you argue with him, if you get on his back about calls, he's going to be even tougher on you. You're better let this guy referee, and when you're upset, turn your back and get on with it. He's a good referee, but he likes to lay the law down early.
Good look at Joel Otto, who always sees a lot of ice time against Mark Messier in the Battle of Alberta. I'm interested in Sather's move putting McSorley on this line with Anderson and Messier instead of Craig Simpson. Here's Anderson breaking out. Now turns back, and he better be careful. Grant Fuhr helps him out. Charlie Huddy, his pass intercepted. Colin Patterson back to Natras, and the Flames drive it down into the Oilers' zone. Merzen stand on his shot. Merzen kept it in and stopped Messier from breaking out. Here's McSorley to Anderson. Over the line they come. In front and through the skates of McSorley. Charlie Huddy keeps it in. His shot deflected by Vernon to the corner. Merzen was taken down by McSorley, and the fans react.
I think, Chris, one of the reasons why you're seeing McSorley out there, not only is Otto playing against Messier, but so is Hunter.
Here's Joel Otto at center. Steve Smith takes him to the board. Randy Gregg up to Messier. The player of the month for February. Messier, who went 12 games prior to that without scoring a goal, passes in front the drive. And Randy Gregg just missed the open corner. Now a lead pass for Bullard, and it's too far, and Gregg goes back to get it. Gregg almost had his first goal since rejoining the Oilers from the Olympic team. Tinelli, shot right on. Joey Mullen, taken to the boards by Gregg. Gregg gets a hand on him. And now Mike Krusielniski starts back for Edmonton. Trying to work around McCrimmon. Puck centered out in front. There's Joey Mullen. Mullen ahead to Tinelli. Tinelli stepped over the red line, cleared it in, and he got his sticks up with Kevin Lowe.
And Tinelli's going to get the penalty. They both high stick, but Tinelli did it first, and he'll be going by himself to the penalty box.
Now with the Hockey Night in Canada update, here's Steve Armitage.
Chris, lots of scoring in Toronto. Tom Fergus puts the Leafs on the board with a quick wrist shot, beating Berthiaume, and that ties the game at one. And then exactly 11 seconds later, Howardchuk will pass to Andrew McBain. He makes it 2-1, and the Jets have just scored again. It is now 3-1, Winnipeg in Toronto.
Here, John Tinelli goes off for high sticking at 15-10.
Well, he did high stick Lowe, but Lowe came back with the stick. The referee almost always gets the retaliator, but not this time. And the Edmonton power play has a chance to tie the game up. And I know that this part of the Oilers team, their power play, is a great concern to Muckler and Stanley.
Not if they play as they did last night against Philadelphia. Simpson is out there, Curry, Gretzky. Bukaboom and Lowe, so they certainly have the firepower.
Well, don't forget, Philadelphia didn't have Poulin, they didn't have Howe, they didn't have some key penalty killers playing that game. And they didn't have Hextall on either. He's a pretty good penalty killer.
Actually, Hextall kind of came and went last night. He made an appearance and then left. Here's Gretzky. Back to Lowe, the shot. That hit a couple of sticks in front before deflecting wide. And that puck was tossed ahead by McCrimmon. Play is whistled down.
Well, Craig Simpson for the Oilers, one of the new breed of the two young players that Sather got for Coffey, you can see is having a wonderful season. He has 12 goals in his last nine games. Another nice thing about him, if you were his coach, 17 of his 32 goals have come on the road. Glenn Sather. What it would be like if he, his team could finish first and force the Flames to play Winnipeg in round one of the playoffs.
Not only is Sather missing Paul Coffey from the point, but Rayo Ruotsalainen as well. And Steve Smith is the defenseman that has served the role best on the point for the Oilers this year. Here's a chance at front. Simpson scores. The power play clicks and it's 1-1.
Well, Simpson proves one thing. He hasn't got a great shot. But he gets it away quickly, and he puts it on the net. And this is a nice, soft pass across from guess who? And there's the shot. And Gretzky had to lift that puck up in the air to get it over the sticks. You see, then it comes down, and Simpson one-times it. And Vernon simply can't get across quickly enough. And you can see how far out Simpson was playing, maybe 20 feet from the net. And it's tough for the defenseman to get that far away from the goal and tie a guy up. Nice goal on the power play by the Oilers. 1-1 with 3:50 to go in the first.
Simpson's 46 from Gretzky and Anderson. It's a power play goal. The two teams have traded power play markers here in the first period. Here's Nieuwendyk to drive, and he hit the outside of the mesh, and the fans thought that one was in. Gretzky back for the Oilers. No doubt inspired by Lemieux's four-point afternoon, which leaves Gretzky now 18 points back in the race for the scoring title. Okunlube intercepts. Being watched by Greg, clears it to the corner, and there's Esa-Tikkanen to Yari Curry. Curry loses it. Poplinski tried to feed it to Nieuwendyk, and it comes outside the line. That goal by Simpson moves him into third place in the goal-scoring category for the league. Only Mario Lemieux and Steve Yzerman, who is now out for the rest of the year, have scored more. John Cinelli in the corner, watched by Muni. Joey Mullen helps out, beats the point, and Dana Merzen was not there, and he'll have to go back and get it. Greg Muni at center, dumps it to the line. Acton went after it. Now Muni gets it again and clears it deeper into the corner where Dave Hannon gives chase. Merzen takes a bump from McTavish. Puck comes to the line, kept in by Acton. Now Shane Cherla for Calgary. Up ahead to Natras. Natras working against Huddy, tried to clear it through for Cherla. Cherla goes after it, comes up with it. McDonald scores!
McDonald's
eighth of the year. Boy, I thought that one went in off the shaft of the stick instead of the blade, but Laney will take it any way they go.
Didn't even get to the back of the net, but it's up on the board.
2-1 Flames. Hunter up ahead to Joel Otto. He's with Patterson. Patterson tried to take the pass, but Kevin Lowe broke it up. McSorley ahead to Messier, too far. Now here's Kevin Lowe. Over the line, Lowe trying to split the defense, can't do it. And Otto starts back. Lead pass for Hunter, and Otto got his stick up with McSorley, and they're fencing behind the play as Anderson gets a shot on goal. 1 minute, 22 seconds left in the first period. 2-1 Calgary. Both teams making changes. And Curry has trouble with the pass. Now Tonelli starts back for the Flames. That lead pass for him was too far. Steve Smith to Krushelnicki. Krushelnicki bottled up by Mullen. Less than a minute to go in the first period. Tonelli against Curry. And here's a chance for Joey Mullen. Shooting right on. And Pure made a good stop on Mullen. Randy Gregg behind Simpson. That slides down the ice. Icing waved off as McInnes goes back. He leaves it behind the net. Mullen around the boards for Bullard. Charlie Huddy pitches in. Curry keeps it in the zone. Craig Simpson just leaves it there as he took a hit from McInnes. Here's Mullen. To McInnes to Tonelli. Just too far. Tonelli at the end of the shift. And icing the call. Let's join Steve Armitage.
Chris, coming up during our first period intermission tonight on Inside Hockey, Brian McFarlane will chat with the one they call the Eagle, Alan Eagle. They'll be talking about international hockey, and Don Cherry will be along with the Coach's Corner.
Harry, you and I thought Eddie the Eagle Edwards was going to make an appearance there, but it should be interesting to hear the comments of Alan Eagleson considering the developments over the course of the Olympic hockey tournament pertaining to the Soviets.
Looks like the Soviets were pulling the North Americans' legs about having premier Soviet players head over to the National League. Maybe the Eagle will enlighten all of us as to what exactly is or might happen.
16 seconds left in the first period. Around the boards, but kept in by Muni. To Anderson. Anderson centers in front. Natras knocks it down, and he'll get it down the ice. And that should do it for period number one, and the Flames with a 2-1 lead. And so the score at the end of the first period is Calgary 2, Edmonton 1.
If you cannot get back once they're gone, Reflexes. It's kind of like losing the elasticity in your underwear. Doesn't snap back very easy.
And on that note, we start the second period. Joel Otto, Tim Hunter, Colin Patterson for the Flames. Line for Calgary that has forced Glenn Sather to move. Marty McSorley up with Glenn Anderson and Mark Messier to match muscle for muscle. Gary Suter, who had 4 points in a game against the Oilers on Boxing Day, feeds it ahead, and here's Tim Hunter. Hunter hits the line. Otto dragged down. Play continues. Kevin Lowe takes over. Otto got up and took a look at Bob Myers. Craig Muni gives off to Anderson. Anderson takes a hit. Back to Muni. And now the puck is just cleared down the ice past Brad McCrimmon. Well, they took that assist away from Mario Lemieux, so Wayne Gretzky has now 17 back of Lemieux in the race for first place in the scoring derby. And that puck just came outside the line offside.
Gretzky or Curry, two of their better, obviously their better scorers, did not have a shot in goal in the first period. Alan McInnes, 35 points in 36 games against Edmonton, fourth in the National Hockey League in scoring, and third in assists. And what a shot this young man has. You'd have to be 3 cents short of full to try and block it.
Well, that's one of the differences between these two teams. When you see McInnes with 59 points, Suter with 67, and the Oilers don't have a defenseman to match that.
Calgary has two in the top four in the league, and that is one of the areas that I'm sure Sather is looking for regarding rounding out his team. A backup goalie, perhaps, with experience in the playoffs, maybe Richard Brodeur, maybe Milosh, maybe Sove, and a power play point man. That might be harder to find than a goalie.
20 other GMs are looking.
defensemen. They're hard to find these days. They don't make them anymore.
Here comes Keith Acton inside the line with McTavish and Hannon. Puck in front. McTavish tried to kick it past Vernon as he was tied up in the goal crease. Jim Poplinski starts back. Gary Roberts has returned to action. Roberts with the shot, gloved by Fuhr. Remember, Roberts went out in the first period. Looked like a hip injury, but he is back and skating a little gingerly, we notice. Puck cleared back into the Oilers zone, a delayed offside. The Oilers clear it to the line. Gretzky to Randy Gregg. Up ahead it goes. Hokanlou breaks up the first Oiler pass. And now Rick Natras takes over. Tried to send away Roberts. Here comes Esa Tiikkanen back the other way. Tiikkanen draped along the boards by Natras. Hokanlou with Jeff Bookaboom pitching in. Simpson takes a hit. Gretzky up with the puck. Gretzky gets by Merzen. Behind the net, the centering pass cleared by Vernon. Here's Tiikkanen. Gretzky goes in front, and the pass to the point is intercepted by Nieuwendyk. It's a three-on-one as Lou catches up with Turla. The drive wide. Nieuwendyk scores!
Well, that was the longest three-on-one I've ever seen. When the puck was going over the Oilers blue line, there was none of the four Oilers caught over their own blue line. As you can see, Turla pulls down Smith, then jumps into play. There's the shot. It's a great shot, and Fuhr made a heck of a save on Turla, but the puck came off the end of the rink right to the Calgary player, Joel Nieuwendyk. And don't give this guy a second around the net. I don't think there's any doubt, Tris, the silversmith can put his name on the Calder Trophy right now.
He has a head start to make sure the spelling is correct. Turla gets the assist. I was surprised Turla took the shot from that far out on a three-on-one. He's not the scorer among that group.
He's never scored in the National League. He really got a lot of mustard on that shot. And it probably was the right play, because if Turla had tried to make the pass in that in close, I think the fella he passed it to would have been in too close to Fuhr to make a good shot. Anyway, he gets the second assist of the night. That's a scoring streak for him.
And Harry, the Flames now go on the power play. Steve Smith was assessed an unsportsmanlike penalty. And so now the Flames have a chance to increase their lead. Rink wide pass for Mullen broken up, and it slides past McCrimmon out to center. Messier giving chase. Here's McTavish with a loose puck, and he was checked by Otto. John Tinelli starts back. There's Joey Mullen in behind Kevin Lowe. Mullen in, and diving back was Craig Muni to make a fine defensive play. Muni takes a look. Acton was breaking, but the pass doesn't get through.
You can't get after Bob Myers perfectly. He will give it to you all the time. Once McSorley, now Smith. Who's next?
Well, Kevin McClellan was added to that group in the first period. He got a misconduct and is still serving it. But icing is called here against the Flames. From the Olympic Saddle Dome in Calgary, this is Hockey Night in Canada. On CB's seconds remaining in his penalty, and here come the Flames, and Lube just missed that pass, which would have given Calgary another two-on-one break. They lead 3-1 here early in this second period. Nieuwendyk with the third Calgary goal. Lou with Bullard and Nieuwendyk. Bullard scores!
Now, Mike Bullard made a heck of a play here. He looked to his teammate as if he was going to pass it. While he was looking, he shot it. Watch this now. Now, watch Bullard. He'll look over here to Nieuwendyk and then shoot it. And he freezes Fuhr. And that's a tough play. It's like a quarterback in football, looking at one side of the field and throwing at the other. And Bullard gets his 39th goal of the year. He's well on the way to 40. He scored 50 before, and he's had five straight years at plus 30 goals.
Terry Crisp likes the way his power play has worked tonight. Second goal with the man advantage, 4-1 Calgary. It is Bullard from McInnes and Lube. And so the Flames have opened this up here very early in the second period. Mike Bullard, the leading point getter amongst the Calgary Flames. That's his 81st point of the season. Here come the Oilers back. Messier trying to make things happen for Edmonton. Shot right on. McSorley causing traffic in front. He's spun around Mike Vernon, but out comes Gary Roberts. Roberts with Otto. To the corner he goes along with Charlie Huddy. Tim Hunter centers it in front. Otto! Roberts! Cure down, and Anderson clears it away.
Well, the Flames are just too quick and too determined for the Oilers at this point in the game.
Here's Anderson, leading point getter in this series so far this year. Messier took a whack at it. It was cleared away. Hunter taken to the boards by McSorley, and we're going to have another penalty. Live on CBC, Hockey Night in Canada.
Well, Tim Hunter, who was on the receiving end of a pretty good hit by McSorley, came back down on McSorley with a stick. See at the top of your screen here? There's the high stick as he knows McSorley's coming in, and he wanted to give him just a little taste of that lumber on the way in hopes of dampening McSorley's enthusiasm. And all he did was give the Oilers the power play, and they need a goal in the worst way.
Gretzky mans the point on this power play. Over to Kevin Lowe. Cross ice pass was blocked by Patterson. Messier. Cross ice. Gretzky's shot deflected. Vernon was fooled by that, but it didn't get through, and it is knocked down the ice. Kevin Lowe back to get it as Neuendijk and Lue come over the boards. The Flames have 17 shorthanded goals this year. Gretzky to Lowe. Intercepted by Lou, but Neuendijk breaks. And Neuendijk takes the pass back to Lowe. Look at the Flames up for McCrimmon as well. And Lowe makes the diving block. And negates a pretty good scoring chance for the Flames.
Kevin Lowe made an excellent play on that. He was in deep trouble, badly outnumbered. And his only chance was to block the shot. And he gambled, guessed, and anticipated the play. Here's the breakout. Lowe loses the puck, but he gets back, and look at the number of red shirts coming. And Lowe makes a nice shot block on Lube, who's got a hot hand.
Glenn Sather looking for a power play marker to get his team back into the game as the Flames have struck for two goals early in this second period. 14-16 remaining, and it's already 4-1 Calgary. Yari Curry around the board. It comes all the way to Gretzky at the left point. Esa Tikkanen to Gretzky. Winds up. It goes off the ankle of Patterson. And now Patterson with the puck will clear it down the ice.
Well, the Oilers are getting one chance. No rebounds, no tip-ins. And they're not recovering many pucks in the offensive zone. And a power play will be in trouble if they don't come up with more loose pucks in the opposition. You have an extra man, you got to use it.
Steve Smith cleared it in, but it's knocked out by Natras. Neuendijk after it, and he steals from Smith. Neuendijk in, and he went diving over the broken stick of Steve Smith, and there will be a penalty against the Oilers. That will do it for the Oilers' man advantage.
Steve Smith gets a 4-minute slashing penalty. He got two for slashing and two for breaking his stick. There's the slash, the broken stick, and here's what he might have got the extra two for. And if he did, that's the second time that he's lost his cool, and Glenn Sather and his teammates have to bail Smith out of trouble, and they don't need to kill a 4-minute penalty off. The game isn't half over yet. They're far from out of it, but they're dealing with the number one power play in the league.
And Harry, on Boxing Day, twice Smith took penalties, which gave the Flames 2-man advantages. So
can't do it. I mean, at this time of the year, it's too important if the Oilers really do want to finish first, and I think they do, to take selfish penalties that you get when you're upset. It's not fair to your teammates, and he won't be very popular, I'm sure, among the coaching staff.
In 27 seconds, the Flames will have a man advantage. That's the time left in Hunter's penalty. Right now, four skaters aside as Mullen clears it in behind the Oiler goal. Charlie Huddy is there with Randy Gregg, Mike Krusielniski, and Craig McTavish. Mullen, Bullard, and McInnes, and Glynn for the Flames. Here's McTavish to Gregg at the line. Randy Gregg, who called the Saddle Dome home for most of this season. And now here comes Bullard back with Hunter out of the penalty box. Bullard hauled down. McInnes rifled it wide, but it was offside.
a big game like
crucial for both teams. I think even more so for the Oilers, who not only have played one more game than Calgary and are behind by one in the standings, but have a tougher schedule from here on in.
Much tougher. The only thing you can say is when the Oilers get going, they could play on the moon and get 2 points. They're not going tonight.
All right, the Flames on the power play, but Glenn Anderson has the puck for Edmondson. Messier clears it down the ice. Calgary has clicked for 2 power play goals already tonight. They've got Tinelli. Neuendijk with it on the right side. Or Otto checked that. He was hit by Greg. McCrimmon moves in around the boards. Tinelli after it with Joey Mullen. Mullen comes up with it. Brian Glynn couldn't keep it in at the point, and Anderson gives chase. Now it's the veteran McCrimmon. He's had a solid season here in Calgary, but gives away the puck here. Anderson with it, and he'll kill some time. 2 minutes, 20 seconds remaining in the double minor to Smith. And now Anderson heads up ice. Oilers could use a goal even if they are a man short.
Nice play by McCrimmon. Hooking up against the toughest guy in the league, cutting it off the board.
Now here comes Bullard. Clears it in, chases after it. Neuendijk's out now with Mullen. Puck comes around the boards, past Suter, and Acton may have a break. He is dumped, and that will do it for the Flames' power play advantage, as Gary Suter will go off for tripping Keith Acton, and that's the end of the power play for Calgary.
Well, the Oilers, Keith Acton in particular, has adopted the feel wood principle. That is, when you feel wood on your body, you go down to try and draw a penalty. Acton's the best in the league, and here's his imitation of Greg Louganis.
And the judges' marks were worth 2 minutes for the Calgary Flames. Yari Curry to Randy Gregg, and these two teams now playing at 4 men aside. There was a minute 54 left in the Oilers' penalty, so neither team will get a man advantage out of this. And now let's join Steve Armitage with some out-of-town scores.
Chris Alfdahlin has scored for the Rangers. They now lead Hartford by a score of 1-0 in the second period. And Brian Bellows and Dino Ciccarelli scoring for the North Stars, who desperately need a win. They lead Chicago by a score of 2-0. Gilmore and Hunter have scored for the Blues, who now lead Detroit by a score of 2-1. Chris?
Steve, we have to ask Harry about that injury to Steve Yzerman. You coached him, and he's just had an MVP-type season. It really is a shame.
Well, I think if you gave the...
Here's a break for Curry. Curry moving in. Didn't get much on that shot, and Vernon makes the save. Now back comes Al MacInnis. 3 Flames at center. Hope can lose. Around Gregg. Shooting it. Pure makes the stop. What a rush by Lou. Come the Oilers as they open it up 4-on-4. Kevin Lowe trying to get around Glynn. Centers it. Gretzky was there, but it didn't come through. Al MacInnis up ahead to Lou for Otto. Otto takes a hit from Lowe. Randy Gregg to Messier. Here comes Kevin Lowe with Glenn Anderson 2-on-2. Anderson drops it. Messier catching up. That wrist shot goes off McCrimmon. And play is whistled down, and there'll be another penalty going against the Calgary Flames.
Well, the Flames are trying to give the Oilers a chance here to get back in the game. Mob Byers is upset. His solution to upsetness is a parade to the penalty box. Colin Patterson gets her, who's the best in the league at not giving up the goal that you can't give up in order to keep your chance of winning, makes a nice stop right there on Hawk and Luke, who gave Dr. Gregg the how do you do before he went by. Grant Fuhr, he may win the Hart Trophy. I was saying about Yzerman, if you gave the Hart Trophy to the player who's most valuable to his team, and his team is fairly successful, Yzerman maybe should win it.
Here's the man who's owned it through the years. Gretzky with the shot, deflects high, centered in front. Anderson Vernon with the save.
Well, Mike Vernon makes a nice stop. Anderson threw some traffic that.
And when you talk about valuable, Mike Vernon certainly ranks right up there.
Well, anytime your goaltender plays as much as Fuhrer, Hextall, or Vernon, they'll get some votes.
Anderson the drive, and that one just missed. Oilers with what they like, a 4-on-3 power play. Simpson's backhand towards the side of the net. He gets it back again for Anderson. Three Oilers behind the net here. Got to get something out in front. They give it away, and here goes Neuendijk. Working against Gretzky. Neuendijk around Gretzky. Shot right on.
Neuendijk has deceiving speed, Chris. Yeah, he's like Gretzky. He doesn't look fast. Nobody catches him from behind.
You could tell from Gretzky's reaction, he knew he was in trouble. Now the Oilers have a 5-on-4 man advantage for the next minute. And the puck slides outside the line. Messier with it. He's being hounded. Lubal stole it, but had his stick knocked away from him. And the Oilers look a little disorganized right now. Four-one Calgary, and the Oilers trying to get back in it. Curry to Huddy. Huddy flips it in, and Simpson will chase it after it. Simpson gets there first to Gretzky. Randy Gregg breaking in from the point. Gretzky tried to feed it there, and the Flames come up with the puck. Gary Roberts. His clearing pass hit Huddy, and now Curry strikes back to Tikkanen. Return pass. And now Gregg tees it up. Shot wide. Krushelniski in front. Tikkanen. Back to Randy Gregg. Essa Tikkanen with Krushelniski providing the screen, but the puck didn't get through. Gregg keeps it in. Flames back at full strength. And Calgary gets it outside the zone and down the ice. That's icing against Calgary, but the fan...
Dyke gets a one-on-one on Gretzky, and Gretzky feels now the way most defensemen feel when he comes down on him. In trouble, feet going four or five directions, and finally beaten. But Grant Fuhrer helps his buddy Gretzky out with a big stop.
Neuendijk has his 46th tonight. That leaves him seven shy of Mike Bossy's rookie goal-scoring record of 53.
And when he scored 53, a lot of people said it will be a long time before that baby's threatened, let alone broken.
Here comes Joe Mullen breaking in, and Randy Gregg him up. No call. Fans aren't happy about that. 7:28 left in what's been a very hectic second period. McClelland is back on, first shift since serving misconduct. McClelland feeds it back to Kevin Lowe. There's an errant pass gobbled up by Brian Flynn, who gets his shot right on. McTavish back to get it. He's checked by Bullard. Right now, the Oilers being outskated. Mullen lost control of it, but McInnes gets it. Flips it into the corner. Jeff Bukaboom for Edmonton. Up to McClelland. He's watched by Tinelli. And play whistled down. And Tinelli and Bukaboom have words. Live on CB. 6:48 remaining in the second period. The two goals in the period, both scored by the Flames, Neuendijk and Bullard.
And if you haven't seen Craig Beauty for a while, he's in getting stitched up. He got hit in the face with the puck. He'll be back shortly.
Bukaboom being watched by Tim Hunter. Joel Otto in for checking. Messier sends it ahead to Charlie Huddy, having quite a season after Huddy rode the pine a lot last year.
I'll tell you what, I bet the Oilers are very happy they didn't trade him. He's been good this year. Best year, perhaps, in this league.
Glenn Anderson at center being watched by Patterson. Patterson missed a lot of time early this season with a hamstring injury. Flames very happy to have him back. He's a good grinding forward. Icing the call against the Oilers with 6:03.
Physical department against the Flames. These Flames are not as tough as they were last year, where they dominated Edmonton physically. Edmonton ought to try it a little bit. I don't think you can just let them skate.
The catch 22 is if you run into penalty trouble, the Flames of the power play to make you pay.
One of the toughest guys on your roster can be your power play against teams who like to play rough.
Mike Gernon clears it ahead to Joe Mullen. He almost lost it to Krushelnicki. McSorley now on a line with Krushelnicki and Hannon. So Glenn Sather starts to juggle them up again, looking for the right combination. Here comes Mike Bullard. Bullard with the blast wide. Tonelli moves in. Tonelli scored the first goal of this game. Tonelli lost it to Dave Hannon. Hannon ahead to McSorley, and he'll play it tough. Not Krushelnicki, but Hannon is in offside ahead of the play in that game.
Well, if the Oiler big guns get shooting the right in the right direction, they can get three goals in one rush.
Big guns are out now. Gretzky and Curry. And here's Joe Neuendijk feeding to Poplinski. Ridden into the boards by Yari Curry. Charlie Huddy around and ahead to Wayne Gretzky. Estetikinen and Curry is in offside.
Nice play by Jimmy Poplinski. Curry was trying to...
Although an interesting chat with Randy Gregg this week, although he did not criticize anybody in particular, he expressed some unhappiness with the fact that the chemistry of Team Canada was upset by the addition of some NHLers late before the Olympics.
Well, chemistry was going to win them more games against teams like the Russians than talent, so he might have a point.
Here come Poplinski, Lube, and Neuendijk breaking out now. Poplinski in. Out in front. Fuhr is out of the net. Here's another chance, and Neuendijk's shot was stopped. MacInnis and Neuendijk both had great scoring opportunity. Curry clears it outside the line, and MacInnis brings it in offside. Now with the Hockey Night in Canada update, here's Steve Armitage.
Chris, it was all Winnipeg in the first period. It's the Jets in the second period. Kumpel passing out in front to Doug Smail. He counts his 13th of the year. It is 5-1 Jets over the Leafs. Chris?
And here at the Saddledome, 4-1, Harry.
It's got to be criminal that Toronto or Minnesota are going to make the playoffs, and four teams that don't make it are going to have more points. They got to do something about that, Chris. It isn't fair.
Are they going to do something?
If Pittsburgh misses and Lemieux doesn't get in the playoffs, you might have the league a little more sympathetic than if New Jersey misses. But regardless of that, you can't have four teams with worse records missing the playoffs than one that makes the playoffs.
Here's Keith Acton behind the net. McTavish in front just missed the pass, and it slides out to center with 3:55 left in the second period. Neuendijk and Bullard have opened up a 4-1 Calgary lead. Here's Acton scooting in. Centers in front. Vernon covered the corner. Gary Roberts behind the net. McTavish took a bump from McDonald, and the Flames clear it down the ice.
Good hit by Kevin Lowe on Shane Cherla. Kevin Lowe, I think there's no question about this, is the Oilers' best defenseman this season.
Randy Gregg against Gary Roberts. McDonald steps in and walked in front and slid it through the goal crease. Nobody touched Lanny McDonald, and now we'll have matching penalties. And Randy Gregg will be one, I think Gary Roberts the other.
Well, there's Messier, went right at Roberts. Messier, who has done diddly squat so far tonight, has decided to get involved. This may be what the Oilers need, a little shot in the arm with one of these scenes. And Messier doesn't fight very often, but he's got a tough one in Roberts. He fights regularly in this league.
You know, there are some who think that if Messier fought regularly, he may be known as the best fighter in the league. I don't think he's fought since the series against the Flames 2 years ago in the playoffs.
Well, this whole thing isn't over yet. It's down in the faceoff circle. If Fuhr's right, we have four Oilers and four Flames, and Hunter is one of them in there. And Sather, I know, feels this is maybe what we needed to get us going. We'll have to wait and see.
Anderson and McCrimmon, Lowe and McDonald, Hunters with Simpson.
Now McDonald, he ran it low after Lowe threw that big check. Here's Hunter and Simpson. Simpson saying, where are some of the cements? I don't do this very often. Especially he's got my visor off. And Glenn Sather had a very emotionless team in the first half of this game. The way that Myers 23 minutes and 16 seconds left to play in tonight's game.
Well, the temperature is indeed rising at the Olympic Saddledome late to the...
...of his two linesmen, Swede Knox and Jimmy Christensen, will sort this out. Remember that anybody who fights after an initial fight breaks out can be thrown out of the game for being in a secondary fight. And nobody knows how the referee's going to sort this out. McDonald and Lowe are going to hear first as they're over at the pen in front of the penalty box getting the rundown from Bob Myers.
This program is copyright and is strictly for the private use of our audience. Any reproduction, retransmission, distribution, or exhibition in whole or in part without the express consent of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation is... And they line up with the Flames. Up with the Flames having a man advantage.
Well, that's the risk you run when you do what Messier did, but if you kill the penalty off, you may have awakened a lot of your teammates, including yourself.
All this happening late in the second period. We have 3 minutes to play, and it's 4-1 Calgary. McInnes will get this power play in operation. Clearing it down into the Oilers' zone. Bullard in after it first, overskates it. And here goes Acton the other way against McInnes. One-on-one. Acton in, was tripped up. And here comes another penalty as Acton, for the second time, playing a man short, draws a Calgary minor.
Well, Acton put a very good little change of pace on McInnes. The referee was at the red line and called this from 90 feet away. And I'm sure his supervisor will tell him that's a tough call from that far away. You had better be sure. And when and if we see the replay, you're going to see Acton take a dive right there. Now, either McInnes is the strongest man that ever played in the National League and can hoist you off your feet with a stick, or Acton hoisted himself off. And we saw Acton do it earlier, and he's a master at it.
I think the Oilers are going to get a minor penalty as well. Second misconduct against the Oilers. And the minor penalty against McInnes negates the man advantage for the Flames. So they're playing four skaters aside as Gary Suter starts down the ice against Huddy. Nice poke check there. Gretzky turns the other way. Tiikkanen trying to catch up. Gretzky drops it for Charlie Huddy. Gretzky was hit and his stick went flying. Gretzky has to pick up his stick at the side of the net. As McCrimmon backhands it ahead to Otto, back to McCrimmon, and out breaks Calgary. Joel Otto just handed it to Steve Smith, and now Charlie Huddy has it with 2 minutes to play in the second period. It's 4-1 Flames. And Steve Smith backtracks behind goaltender Grant Fuhr.
And the fans are all yelling at Smith to shoot the puck. We all remember the night he did.
2 years ago, game seven. Lou. Having his best season ever, and offside was Nieuwendyk, and Lou doesn't like the call because he doesn't think he went inside the zone. 1:34 left in the second period. There's 18 seconds remaining in the minor to Messier, and then the Oilers will have a power play for 33 seconds.
34 left in the second period, and it would be in the Oilers' best interest in any chance of winning this game to try and get one before this period ends.
Gary Suter bouncing back off a so-so year last season, and Suter takes quite a hit from Craig Beauty at center ice. Here's Acton back for the Oilers. Well, I have to have another look at that hit. Wow. Acton behind the net. Oilers now at full strength. Steve Smith's shot didn't get much of it, and Vernon makes the stop. Anderson gives way to Acton. Smith at the point. Acton walking in. His shot blocked by McCrimmon. Loose puck. Flames get it and get it outside the zone with under a minute to go. Here's Lou working against Smith. For Joel Otto, and Yari Curry starts back for Edmondson. Curry to the line. Stopped there by Glenn. Glenn Sather said before last night's game he wanted his team to play with more creativity. I don't think we're seeing it tonight.
Well, one thing Yari Curry's got to start to do is finish the rush. He turns away all the time, and Tikkanen has drawn a penalty as it looks like he was speared or high stick. Myers saw it, and Gretzky's over there appealing for 5 minutes.
Joel Otto was the culprit. Otto is headed for the penalty box, and Glenn Sather awaits whether or not it's five or two.
Well, if it's spearing, it's got to be five, and you're out of the game. So I don't think it's spearing, or Otto would be headed to the dressing room. Sather's not too happy, and I don't know where Tikkanen got it, but he doesn't look very comfortable.
Well, you heard Glenn Sather calling for a match penalty.
Now Sather's yelling at the crowd. And it's very fortunate that we don't have a mic on the bench for everyone who was at home. Sather carrying on a running conversation with about 200 fans behind the bench. When you're down 4-1, you better have a good argument.
Welcome to the Battle of Alberta.
I don't think those fans were telling Sather. 4 minutes Otto gets. Let's have a look at it. The bottom of the screen right there. He gave him a slash and then cross-checked him. And Myers was over to the left, just out of the sight on your screen, and he gave him 4 minutes. Sather thinks it should be five. So does Gretzky. But Gretzky and Sather are outnumbered by 19,300 fans, plus Otto.
Nevertheless, a great opportunity for the Oilers to get back in this game. They already had a minute.
25 seconds, but they'll have 3 minutes and 35 seconds at the start of the third period, perhaps, on the power play if they don't draw one themselves.
Gretzky, Anderson, Simpson, Smith, and Huddy on the power play. Oilers need a late goal. Anderson to Gretzky behind the net. Back to Huddy. Shot. Rebound scores. Glenn Anderson. And the Oilers needed that.
7 seconds left to go in the period. A very difficult time to give a goal up. But Wayne Gretzky gets behind the net. The four guys are turned around looking at Gretzky, and by the time the forward gets back out to try and block the shot from the point, it comes off the end of the rink. Take advantage of that nice mental lift in the third period.
Anderson's 32nd from Gretzky and Huddy. It's a power play goal late in the second period, and it turned out to be a wild one. So the score after the second period, Calgary 4, Edmonton 2.
7-1, and join our announcers Bob Cole and Scotty Bowman.
Fired and nearly made an 8. Here's Allen coming up. Couldn't scoop it in front. Domfus stopped immediately by Wilson. Hortnell turning out of the zone. A pass to the line. Here's Ginichak. Just scooped it across the line. Hortnell was covered. Lands. Long shot missing. And it's Smale coming back down the ice for the Winnipeg Jets. Wilson is with them. Wilson and Smale head off to the bench. Maple Leafs stymied here in a second. Stymied in a first. And the Jets looking very, very good.
Well, you got that extreme confidence that comes with wins, and they had two against Hartford and Vancouver, and they really dominated this game.
Biggest cheer from the crowd. On the announcement, 1 minute left in the period. 45 seconds now. Lehman tapped up the puck. Fed a pass down the ice. Osborne racing in. Carlisle checked him. Puck off to the corner to Fergus. He's checked by Waters. Lehman has to race to the far side. Steen is there watching him. Steen nearly got away. Richardson kept it in. Near the line, turns. Now had it knocked off his stick by Steen. I afraid he stopped it near center. Poked it back in. I afraid he couldn't beat Carlisle. The veteran knocked the puck back. Fergus from the line. Oh, that just dribbled wide of the far post. 5 seconds left in the period. Thalming poked at it. To end the period. The shots in the period, Scotty, were 19-4 for Winnipeg, and a scrap started right at the horn. Lehman and Waters want to go at
the Jets.
All set to start the third period of play here at the Olympic Saddle Dome. It's 4-2. The Flames leading the Oilers, but Edmondson with a man advantage. They scored a power play goal, Harry, with 7 seconds to play in the second period. And because it was a double minor to Joel Otto, they go back on the power play here.
Well, they've been outplayed. There's no question about that for the first two periods. They can get back close if they can score in this power play.
Joe Nieuwendyk gets it out to center. Hoekenlube, the other penalty killer. Gretzky, Anderson, Simpson for the Oilers up front. As Calgary clears it down the ice, the Flames have outshot the Oilers 20-16 through two periods of play. Anderson, bad pass, and we've seen a lot of that tonight. The Flames clear it back in. Esa-Tikkanen will try it. He was quite pleased with the Finns' silver medal performance in Olympic hockey, as was Jari Kurri, of course. Vernon off the glass, can't get it out. Tikkanen at the line, and now it hops outside the line and offside. Now with the Hockey Night in Canada update, here's Steve Armitage.
When it rains, it really pours on the poor old Leafs. This is Mark Kupple about to make it 8-1 for the Winnipeg Jets. That's his first goal. He has two assists. Obvious displeasure on the part of the Leafs fans as they trail by seven. Chris?
Boy, those paper bags are being seen more and more at the Gardens, aren't they, Harry?
Funny thing about the Leafs, though, now they probably will finish fourth, although Minnesota, I see, is winning tonight, so it's not a for sure. But Toronto has given Detroit all kinds of trouble during the season, and they're going to play Detroit in the first round if they finish fourth, and Detroit's going to play without Yzerman.
Two-line pass called against the Flames. Let's take a look at what happened in that free now. Out on the power play, 44 seconds left in the double minor to Joel Otto. The Oilers scored in the first half of that penalty, and would dearly love to close within one. In case you missed it, this is the final regular season meeting between these two teams. The series even at 3 wins apiece with 1 game tied. And the Flames lead the Oilers by 1 point in the Smythe division as the puck is cleared into the Oiler bin.
Well, Alan McCarron, I hope he makes it. If he's as good a doctor as he's a hockey player, I'd like to go to him if I'm sick.
He's dedicated at everything he does. Charlie Huddy shot through traffic and Vernon made the stop. Here's Gretzky. Smith broke in, Simpson for the slot, scores! And the Oilers are with one.
Well, I don't know whether they deserve to be back in this game, but they're back in it. And Simpson is deadly on the power play. He scored earlier on a nice pass across on the power play, and watch him get right in the middle of the box. Gretzky gets the puck, makes a turn. There's Simpson. Here's the pass. And a great shot after a great pass. And again, Simpson gets 15, 20 feet away from the net, where you're daring the defenseman to come out and tie you up, and you're trying to lure the forwards to come back from the point and take you. And as a result, sometimes neither happen, and you get a very clear shot.
Wayne Gretzky gets his third assist. Charlie Huddy also figures in the scoring on Craig Simpson's second of the game, 47th of the year. It's 4-3 as McCrimmon tees it up right on Grant Fuhr. One goal game. Flames leading 4-3. Hoekenlube taken down hard, and back comes Simpson with Gretzky. Glenn Anderson on that right wing. Gretzky in the forecheck, and Suter sends it up ice. Poplinski steps over the red line, and the Flames will make a line change. Simpson has 4 goals in 2 games. Gretzky has 8 assists in the last 5 periods.
He was hinting he's going to take a run at Lemieux in the intermission interview.
Mario had 3 assists earlier today. Gretzky's matched them now. Here's Joey Mullen. Offside is Mike Bullard just ahead of the play. We're back at the Olympic Saddledome. Chris Cuthbert, Harry Neal, Steve Armitage in the Hockey Night in Canada crew. 4-3 Calgary. They had led 4-1. And the Oilers send it down the ice. And Rick Natras touches it, icing the call. And Kent Bruce starting to get short again.
Well, Edmonton's level of play, as far as intensity is concerned, has picked up ever since come involved with Roberts. I guess when one of the premier players on hockey show, he very quickly said the ones that go in.
Mike Bullard getting set on this faceoff against Craig McTavish. Wins the draw. That was a tough one for Fuhrer through traffic. Here's Bullard working from the side. Backhand. And Fuhrer had the pad down up against the post. Back comes Craig McTavish. He leaves it for Hannon. Dave Hannon takes a hit from Nashville. Now back come the Flames. It's Bullard and Mullen. Bullard to the line, drops it. Here comes Merzen in, and he couldn't get through traffic. Randy Gregg takes a look for the Oilers. He carries it out to center. Tiikkanen just deflects it into the Flame zone. And behind the play, Tiikkanen was jostling with Merzen, I believe. And they'll both go off. So more penalties, this going to either side.
Well, double penalty, so there'll be no one shorthanded. Tiikkanen for tripping. Merzen for cross-checking. And what the Flames have to be careful about here, especially with the Edmonton firepower, is to sit back and try and kill the rest of the game off. They have to go on the offense a little bit. And Grant Fuhrer has done tonight what he does better than any other goal.
They're fighting Majors. And with Messier back in action, that's going to help this Oiler comeback, you would think. Certainly make it a little bit tougher for the Flames. Now Lanny McDonald's at center, along with Gary Roberts and Joey Mullison. Lanny's played a little bit of center this year, and he isn't complaining. As long as he plays, Lanny's happy. Here's Krushelnicki in, and it's offside.
Consecutive years, plus 30 goals. What a steal Cliff Fletcher made when he traded to Joe Mullen for singles.
That was the big trade before the deadline 2 years ago.
Maybe there's another one. Lots of talk and no action. You know, one thing near the trading deadline, managers are afraid to trade too quick, too far away from the deadline in case a better one comes up. So you may not see anything till tomorrow, but I think you'll see a few things around the league.
Look, Fletcher has certainly a lot of cards to play.
He'd like another defenseman, perhaps, especially now that McCowan will not be coming back this season. And he's looking for a backup goal.
Al MacInnis sends away McDonald. He already has one tonight. Lanny into the zone, turns, clears it behind the goal. Kevin Lowe leaves it there for Anderson. Anderson, a long pass for Gretzky. It slides down to Mike Vernon. Up to Hook and Lou, he let go, and Anderson takes over to Craig Simpson. Simpson clears it down into the Flame zone. Brad McCrimmon back to get it. Huck and Neuendijk in the back of the skate. Here's a chance as Anderson had possession, but couldn't really get control of it. Here comes Hokkanen with Poplinski. The trailer shooter scores!
Well, that was a 4-on-2.
Into the game, just 4 points back of Ray Bourque in the race for most points among defensemen. And he has really risen to the occasion against the Oilers this year. Back in comes Lube. And his rolling shot handled by Fuhrer. So the Flames have restored a two-goal lead here. Still plenty of time to go. 14 minutes, 27 seconds. Neuendijk and Lou both get assists on that goal by Gary Suter, his 14th of the year. Huddy flips it high into the air. McCrimmon around the boards for Joel Otto. Dave Hannon forechecking. Hannon comes up with it to Gretzky. Gretzky centers in front. Huddy came in, but Poplinski was there for Calgary. We'll see a lot of number 99 down the stretch. Loses it. Otto the shot. Rebound. And Fuhrer made two saves. And a Flame was knocked heavily into the Oiler goal. It's Shane Sherlock.
Charlie Huddy is going to get a penalty, and he really ran Shane Shirley into the net, and Grant Fuhr was lucky to get out of the way. I don't think he got all the way out of the way. And I'm sure that Sather's heart was in his throat when he saw Sherlin knock down Fuhr. There's a good stop. Now, here's another one. You can see that Fuhr didn't even see Sherlin coming, and Huddy was just trying to run him out from in front, getting the rebound. That's all it takes to lose a goaltender for 2 or 3 weeks. And can you imagine that the Edmonton Oilers, one of the odds-on favorites to win the Stanley Cup, what would happen if Fuhr got hurt for the first week of the playoffs? They might be out.
Shane Cherla's all right. Charlie Huddy's in the penalty box. We'll be right.
It's the final now. The Hartford Whalers have defeated the Rangers by a score of 3-1. Paul McDermott scoring the third goal for the Whalers. Chris?
Here's Steve, a two-goal advantage for the Flames as they get set to go on the power play. They've scored twice with a man advantage. The Oilers have all three of their goals on the power play.
And I'm saying their power play's no good.
It's getting better. Suter, nice pass to Bullard. He wraps it around the boards. They'll try and beat those point men again. Neuendijk, he has a power play goal tonight. There's Lube. Takes his time and now goes to Suter. High shot. Bullard feeds it right back. McInnes has an opening. His shot blocked by McTavish. Bullard and Neuendijk knocked down in front. Another penalty coming up, and Neuendijk took that shot off the ankle, and he's really shaken up now.
Well, I don't think Neuendijk was hurt when he was knocked down in front of the net, but he was hurt when McInnes hit him with one of his bullets in the ankle. What a loss this would be.
Oh, boy.
Neuendijk's ankle was broken, or maybe he got hit in the face, too. I thought it was his ankle. Perhaps it was his face on the check and his ankle on the shot.
I think that was it. Cross-check across the mouth, and then McInnes really let fly with a bullet.
Well, I think this writhing has got a lot more to do with his ankle than the small cut on his lip. Now watch. There it is. There's how he got hurt. He hurt his mouth. Now watch him getting up. Now here he is getting up. Oh, my Lord. Right on the outside of the ankle.
And while they...
Well, the Oilers are really in a tough spot now. For a minute and 20 seconds, they're going to be down two men. And then for 3 minutes and 40 seconds, they're going to be down one should there be no further penalties.
Against the best power play in the NHL, Neuendijk receiving attention at the bench. He has not gone to the dressing room as yet. You're right. When that skate comes off, it's going to swell up tomorrow.
Trouble with those ankle shots is that they can be cracked or broken. You won't know until tomorrow.
Here goes the power play. McInnes and Suter, they're the quarterbacks. Messier, the lone forward for the Oilers. 5-on-3. They play in the box, and now McInnes tried to tee it up, lost it in his skates. Here's Bullard from a sharp angle, and Fuhr made the skate save. Mullen knocks it off the boards. Here's Otto in front, just shot wide. Mike Bullard. They'll wait for a good shot. They've got lots of time, and they lead by two. Here comes the shot, deflected just wide. Mullen, another chance. And that might have hit the post. Here's Bukovic with a chance to get it out, or Smith, and he does.
Well, what the Flames are trying to do with the Oilers down two men is draw the two penalty killers to the point, slide it in quickly so there's a two-on-one on the lone skater in front of the Edmonton net.
Just 15 seconds left of the first Oiler penalty. Here's Suter to Bullard. Now the Flames may have to hurry with the two-man advantage. McInnes and Suter. Here's Mullen. McDonald goes to the net. The puck comes out, and the Oilers, Charlie Huddy returns. So it's now a one-man advantage. So a big part of the battle is now over for the Oilers as far as killing this penalty. There's still 3 minutes and 20 seconds remaining in Muni's major. Here comes big Brian Glynn, native of Iserlohn, West Germany. clear it right back out again. Lanny McDonald wheels. Flynn drops it back for McDonald. In turn to Lou, shooting, deflected high over the glass and out of play.
Hawk and Lou really got a hold of that one, and there's was a speed skater, a youngster at Stouffville, Ontario, and as a juvenile speed skater, he beat Gaetan Boucher one night.
Love to be on the Olympic oval right now. He's got lots of room to skate, killing this penalty. Neuendijk is back out, and he almost took a stick in the face from Steve Smith. So Joe Neuendijk is back, and that's good news for Flame fans. And from the faceoff, Suter. Shot deflected. Neuendijk somehow cut his stick on that. He's got great reflexes. Bullard winds up, scores!
Gere thought he had that shot. He got a bit of it, but not enough of it. He stopped about one quarter of the puck. The other three quarters went through his leg. And it was a hard shot by a guy who can really shoot him, Mike Bullard. I think that was the final nail in the Oiler coffin for tonight. And maybe Winnipeg's going to give Edmonton a struggle in the first round. Should they finish first and force Edmonton to play them? I don't know how true that is. Winnipeg's a much tougher and stronger team this year. I don't know whether they're good enough to beat Edmonton. Maybe they'll take them and test them a little more than they did last
year. Neuendijk and Suter get assists on Mike Bullard's 40th of the year. Remember, the Flames are still on the power play because Beauty's penalty was a major. It's 6-3. Puck kept in by McCrimmon. Nice play there. It's at the line and now comes out.
I guess Reisner did know something about the power play. He talked to him for 20 seconds and he scored.
Randy Gregg to Dave Hannon. The Oilers trying to get out of this without any more damage, and then they'll really have to mount the comeback. Flynn takes a hit from low. But the Oilers have been playing catch-up all night long and may have fallen behind too far.
Not very often does a team come from behind three goals twice in the same game. That's what the Oilers are facing right now.
Well, Bob Myers has just called another penalty. Randy Gregg, I believe, is going, and perhaps one of the Flames is...
Joel Otto gets the penalty, much to his surprise. Randy Gregg went all the way over to the penalty box. He thought he had it. Gretzky complained to Myers, and Myers turned around and said, no, no, Joel Otto for holding at 10:29. And the Oilers had another 120 to kill in Muni's penalty, so they'll get out of this playing 4-on-4. This is what they used to love before they put the Edmonton rule in that doesn't allow this very often anymore with coincidental penalties. But 6-3... for the Flames, and 30-19 for the Flames summarizes pretty fairly the difference in the two teams so far tonight.
Six of the nine goals have been scored on the power play tonight. Here's Brad McCrimmon. They're playing at even strength right now for a minute 20, and then the Oilers will have a man advantage. Kevin Lowe up to Gretzky. He has three assists tonight. To Yari Curry. Curry at the line, tangled up in his skates. Gretzky flips it over the line, and Holcomb Lube takes over. Another strong night for Lube, having his best season ever. 38 goals, 77 points, career highs coming into this game. Pure out of the net, around for Lowe. And the Oilers have to make things happen quickly with 8:42 to go. Here comes Gretzky. Spins away from one, but falls down, and there goes Neuendijk. Gregg trying to catch up. Neuendijk and Buehr with a great save as Neuendijk looks to the ceiling.
And there's that deceiving speed that I talked about earlier that Joe Neuendijk had.
Gregg had a pretty good angle on him, too, but Neuendijk did just beat him to the net.
And he started almost from a stop when he recovered the puck after Gretzky had a blowout.
Winding down the Craig Beauty major penalty, and then the Oilers will have a man advantage. Messier at center ice. Across to Steve Smith. Back on is Muni. Here's Messier's shot deflected. Knocked out of the air by Al MacInnis, but the Oilers touch it, so play continues. And MacInnis gets it outside the line. So now the Oilers have a man advantage. 25 seconds remaining in the penalty to Joel Otto.
You know, a stat they don't keep is who won the one-on-one battles for the puck. You don't have to keep them all night tonight to know the team in red won about 55 more than the team in white.
Here's Messier. Hands it off to Smith. There's the shot through traffic. Vernon made the stop. Rebound. Huddy scores!
7:31.
Penalty had expired. 10:29. Charlie Huddy gets the fourth Oiler goal. It's not over. 6-4 Calgary. And we may have quite a finish. Simpson and Smith get the assist, and Simpson's had quite a night with a couple of goals and now that assist. Get low behind the net. Tried to feed ahead to Dave Hannon. It gets through, and now ahead to Krusilniski. Krusilniski over the line, offside. Marty McSorley was just ahead of the play.
The Jets are blasting the Leafs 10-1. Dale Hawerchuk with 6 points. Rick Five has scored. It's now 2-2 Chicago, Minnesota, and Detroit on top of St. Louis 4-3. Chris?
And the Winnipeg Jets, Steve, will meet the Edmonton Oilers next on Monday in Winnipeg. Next game for the Calgary Flames is also Monday against the Pittsburgh Penguins and Mario Lemieux. Here come the Flames, Lanny McDonald and Gary Roberts. Drop pass, and Kevin McClellan was the only man near the puck.
I wonder whether Kevin McClellan called for it. Sometimes players will call the player's name that has the puck, and he can't turn around and look at it, and he drops it on a hook pass.
Here's Shane Cherla's pass for Roberts broken up, and Kevin McClellan starts back. A couple of tough guys in Cherla and McClellan out on the ice right now. Active, takes a hit, Smith the shot, Vernon a big stop. Pressure's on, and they hold it in the goal crease as the Oilers come close to drawing within one.
Well, Vernon made a nice stop, then he did a good job to cover the loose puck that was sitting in the crease of two unlikely combatants in the fisticuff department. Acton and McDonald are threatening to go at it. That kind of a fight nobody might win. I bet a little on McDonald. Speed skater, but he's a little stronger than Keith.
Hey, Acton has that fighter stare, though.
Well, we're going to see whether he can take a punch here. Lanny McDonald has had enough of the stare, and Acton has watched a lot of fights in his career and is doing a masterful job at hanging on.
I think the last time Keith Acton was in a fight was against Wayne Gretzky, and that was a little more even.
Well, now we got some other people involved, and down here we've got Hunter and Smith with one linesman to count for the knockdowns at the bell.
That's Shane Cherla and Steve Smith.
Oh, Shane Cherla's twisted. Cherla can fight, but he's outweight, he's outmanned here in the weight department and in the reach department. But I don't think that's going to slow Cherla up. This is the only bout that's taking place now. There's a lot of pulling each other at the other end with the other eight skaters.
This is the last meeting of the regular season, but they might be thinking ahead to the playoffs right now. Acton and McDonald have gone to the penalty box, and that allows Christensen to help Sweet Knox with the heavyweights.
Well, these two guys will be throwing out for sure. Geez, I love those guys that laugh when they're fighting as if it's fun. Can you believe it? I saw Cherla and Wendell Clark when Cherla was with Medicine Hat and Clark was with Saskatoon have about a two-minute fight, both cut, both laughing through the whole thing. And here we got Roberts and McClellan.
I didn't think Kevin McClellan could stand by and watch that long.
And Roberts doesn't need a written invitation to get into one of these.
He's gone with Messier. For McClellan, it's his third fight in two games.
Well, Roberts, he'll do anything to stay in the lineup. He had a little taste of the pine about a week ago and didn't like it. And the one thing Calgary's got, They both fell to the ice. And in what has been a fairly tame game, with 6 minutes and 14 seconds to go, this all broke out.
We'd like to welcome viewers of the Winnipeg-Toronto game. This is the Battle of Alberta. Chris Cuthbert, Harry Neal, Steve Armitage at the Olympic Saddledome, where a relatively tame Oiler Flames game has erupted here in the third.
2-1.
Joey Mullen will serve the penalty. And the Oilers go on the power play with Gretzky, Simpson, Anderson, Lowe, and Messier. Craig Simpson, who has a pair of goals tonight, ahead to Gretzky with three assists. Into the zone it goes. Anderson first to the puck. He had four goals last night. And now the puck slid by Gretzky and out to center. Shots on goal, 31-23 in favor of Calgary. Inside the line, Gretzky couldn't control it, and Neuendijk, who has had a strong game again for the Flames, clears it to Lube and down into the Oilers' zone. Kevin Lowe being watched by Lube. Charlie Huddy now comes out onto the ice. Lowe to Anderson. His pass goes to McCrimmon, and he slams it down into the Oilers' zone.
And the Oilers have not been able to get over the Flame blue line and with control of the puck. This is the third icing in the first minute of this power play.
50 seconds left in the man advantage. Jim Christensen went down at the blue line, and now Esa Tikkanen turns. Rick wide. Gretzky takes it. Huddy trails him. Gretzky gives off to Huddy. There's the shot. That one went wide. Huddy has the fourth Oiler goal, and now Joel Otto sends it down the ice. 27 seconds left in the manpower advantage for the Oilers. Curry to Tikkanen. Stopped there by McInnes. Gregg across ice to Charlie Huddy. Working against Brian Glynn, who has them all tied up. And McInnes around the glass and down the ice. 4 minutes, 20 seconds left in the third period. The Flames lead by two. Crowd giving their team a rousing ovation for their job of penalty killing here. Here's Craig McTavish. Behind the goal, Mike Krushelnicki gives chase against John Tinelli. McSorley's there. He gets it to McTavish. Looking to center it. McTavish knocked off the puck. Kept in by Munich. There's a shot deflected just wide. Fuller backhands it. Kept in by Lowe. And now it comes out. And the Flames are at full strength with a two-on-one. Tinelli deflected off a stick and up over the glass out of play.
On the Hockey Night in Canada scoreboard, Federko has scored for the Blues. It is now tied at four, Blues and Red Wings.
Here it's a two-goal Calgary lead. Harry, a stat that surprised me is that the Oilers have only come back four times this year in the third period to win games. Here's Hunter with the drive, and Fuhr just got a piece of it. They're trying to make it five tonight, but their work's cut out for them.
That used to be a bit of a patent for the Oilers. Get behind and come back with a flurry of goals sometime during the game and snatch a victory right out of the jaws of defeat.
Here's Joel Otto leaving for Hunter. He took a hit from Lowe, and Lowe's stick ended up knocking down one of his teammates. Kevin Lowe got the stick up as he went to hit Tim Hunter, and unfortunately the recipient was Jeff Bukaboom, his defensive partner.
Well, let's have a look at it and see exactly how this happened. Kevin Lowe, who's thrown some good checks tonight, gets a hold of Hunter, but you can see his stick goes right over Joel Otto and hits his buddy, Jeff Bukaboom, right in the face.
Highly likely.
Jeff Bukaboom, a tough guy. Let's see what caused him to fall down. Ooh, and a stick across the face. He does it. He doesn't appear to be cut. Well, he's cut a little bit there, but he's a little groggy. Now, he played for Terry Crisp. He played junior hockey in Sault Ste. Marie, and it's 3 minutes, 4 seconds to play. It's 6-4 Calgary. McCrimmon off the boards and out to center ice. Team's playing at full strength. Otto, Hunter, and Patterson for the Flames. Anderson, Simpson, and Messier have been reunited for the Oilers. Oilers need goals now. This line started tonight with McSorley on the wing, but here comes Messier. Out in front, and Lowe shot wide. And Lowe takes Suter down behind the net. What a good setup for Kevin Lowe.
Well, everybody thought Messier was going to cut back into the middle, and he just kept going wide. Lowe came off the point. Nice pass for Messier, but Lowe missed the net.
Here's Gretzky with Huddy. On the backhand, it rolls weak and wide. McKinnis flips it down the ice. Icing is waved off. Tikkanen deflects it into the center ice zone, and Blue sends it back in. Under 2 minutes to play as Gretzky breaks down the ice with Tikkanen. 2-on-2. They crisscross. Tikkanen right on, and Vernon's there. Randy Gregg shoots, and that one was off the target. Charlie Huddy the crowd.
Well, the puck was rolling as it came back to Huddy. He tried just to get the shot on the
from the draw. The Oilers get control. They need a goal now so they can get Fuhr out of the net to try to get that equalizer. Joey Mullen tries to knock it loose. Mullen out ahead for Tonelli, and Randy Gregg will win that race. Mike Krusielniski has McSorley open. Here's Marty McSorley. Dave Hannon catching up on the play. Hannon in the corner. Being watched by Merson. Tonelli helps out. Here come the Flames. Mike Bullard. He'll have to be considered as a star. That shot is high. Bullard with a pair of goals, including his 40th tonight. Craig Simpson has two for the Oilers. Under a minute to go. Ahead to Simpson. He leaves it for Anderson. Grant Fuhr has left the net. The Oilers have an extra attacker on. Gretzky keeps it in. Lou behind the goal. Lost it to Simpson. Anderson. Gretzky is there. But Lou gets it around the boards. And it goes to the blue line and out. Shot down the ice just wide by Joel Otto. And icing is the call with 24 seconds left.
Is a bad play when the other team's got it. And when the trainer comes dancing down the length of the dressing room and tells you the general manager wants to talk to you, there's a lump in your throat, I can assure you.
From the faceoff, Flames win the draw, and McCrimmon clears it down and in.
And way down behind the play, Marty McSorley, Jocko, Gary Suter, and then two Flames come in. So we're going to have everybody on the ice here into it.
These
combatants. Every time they get McSorley free, a Flame seems to want to take a shot at him. All they can say now is we'll see you in the playoffs, we hope.
Well, for two periods, Chris, this was a nice game. But it's not ending on a nice note. And I can tell you one thing, the fans ought not to get involved with the players, and the players should stay away from going over the glass.
Jeff Bukaboom is up, Dave Hannon, and this has turned into a rather ugly scene. And another chapter in the Battle of Alberta.
Well, the fans have been riding the Oilers, but I think that the same thing goes on at Northlands. If the circumstances were the same, and I know it's easy to say, but it's hard to do, that I wouldn't pay much attention to them. But obviously something was thrown into the Oiler bench. And these fans, I mean, fans that tangle with players hanging over the bench, their IQs are so low, you got to water them once a week. I mean, that's a dangerous practice. Sitting beside some yo-yo who thought he was tougher than all the players.
And a young lady is being helped out by the St. John's ambulance people here with an ice pack on her head. So perhaps some of the debris that was thrown at the Oilers bench hit an unfortunate fan. Here's Craig McTavish breaking in as we count it down here. A very important win for the Flames. They will take a 3-point lead over the Oilers, still with the game in hand in the Spice Division. The Flames beat the Oilers.
Unnoticed in a hockey game. That is the case tonight.
Well, now we've got a skirmish going back of the goal. McClelland was in there. That started with Tiikkanen racing into the corner. McSorley and Risebrough. And Johnson. And McDonald as well. All involved. Sure who got hold of whom back there, but really no punches were throwing, just a lot of pushing.
It's always very scary though, Don, when the gloves come off and you have those sharp skates. And Sorley and McDonald.
Well, McSorley, who came to the Oilers from Pittsburgh, trying to throw some punches at Lanny McDonald. Now he's anxious to go after anybody. And Johnson appeared willing to accommodate him. Now McDonald gets back into it. Fogelin is there as well. Sheehy also gets involved. And there's Risebrough and Tiikkanen pairing off. McClelland is being held at the penalty box area by the linesman.
See, that gives the Calgary Flames an extra man on the ice. I wouldn't want to be an official for all the money that you're paying. They deserve it, trying to break up those fights. But let's face it, they're going to get one of a shot every once in a while, too.
Well, when the officials came into the building tonight, they had a very serious expression on their face, and I'm sure they anticipated that they might have a busy night here at Northlands Coliseum. There was one outbreak in the first period. Things have remained relatively calm until this incident with 7:25 left here in the third, and Marty McSorley and Lanny McDonald, the main combatants, and McSorley and McDonald appear anxious to go at it again.
Well, McSorley better be very careful because he's given Finn a very difficult time and could cost him some suspension if he keeps that up.
Lee Fogelin, the assistant captain, comes over to try and calm McSorley down and convince him that getting involved further will do him absolutely no good at all. But McSorley is intent upon getting back at somebody. He's now over challenging the Flame bench.
And Petillo and Hunter down there, they're probably giving him some verbal abuse trying to get McSorley going even more.
Two players actually from the Flames that many thought would be involved tonight, Petillo and Hunter, have not been involved in any of the altercations.
So all defensively.